the year is 2011. It is a great time of innovation for the video games industry. But it's also a time of despair and confusion. Video games follow the same linear path and same methodology, and risk being the same. There is one game that promises to be different, promises to be challenging. I won't stop until I've played them all. Hi there, I'm 4G and I'm...
Hey guys, what did... The coat, like, it's winter, you moron! Ginger.
Hi there folks, 4G here, about to review a game that's part of a series that is really close to my heart. Basically, the game I'm reviewing is Deus Ex Human Revolution. Now folks, time for a history lesson, and I promise I'll try and keep this as quick as possible. The first Deus Ex was released in the year 2000, and in my opinion is still the greatest game ever made, hands down. It blended RPG, first person, action, adventure, and made it into an excellent blend. It was brilliant. It had open environments, memorable characters, a unique RPG skill system, and augmentations which were a good innovation for the game, and blended well into the storyline. It was really well done, and I haven't seen any game do anything equal to that standard to this very day. I mean, the graphics are really terrible now to nowadays standards, but it's worth checking out. If you've got a... well, any PC can run it, so go check that out. Then many years later, the sequel came out, Invisible War, and that, again, was a pile of dog shit. Seriously, it took out the skill system, it made it into a corridor shooter, the memorable characters were gone, and in the first one, your actions mattered, you had to make choices. This one, nothing mattered. The storyline was always going to carry on the same regardless, nothing changed, it was absolutely terrible. Around 4 years ago, Deus Ex Human Revolution was announced as Deus Ex 3, and I personally could not wait. I was really looking forward to this game. I was a bit sceptical at first, because how Invisible War turned out, but I gave it a chance. Will it live up to the hype? Only one way to find out. The game has you playing the role of protagonist Adam Jensen, who is a security officer for Sarup Industries. The story starts off with Adam going about his normal day, he's doing some security rota stuff, and then, of course, naturally, everything goes completely wrong. Sarup Industries gets attacked, people get killed, basically the shit hits the fan. Of course, naturally, Adam's stuck in the middle of all this, and he gets seriously wounded after trying to save his love interest, Megan Reed. Unfortunately, he doesn't succeed in rescuing her, and he ends up being operated on and augmented to save his life. Unfortunately, this is also against his own will, and this is one of the plot points in the storyline. One important element of the story is also the fact that it's actually a prequel. It's set 25 years before the events of the first game transpire. So the nanotechnology that we saw in Deus Ex 1 hasn't even been invented yet. So we get to experience biomechanical augmentations instead. Think of it more like robotic parts added to the human body, and you pretty much get the idea. Naturally, the augmentation technology is nowhere near as advanced, but it does play into the plot really well because it's relatively new and there's this theological debate going on. What makes us human, whether we should be augmented or shouldn't be augmented.
I do not support what you and your company are doing to mankind. I believe it's extremely dangerous.
Naturally, I'd go for augmentation. How badass would it be to have all these powers? It'd be amazing. But for some reason, some idiots disagree and just don't like the idea of it. So there's protests and disagreements. But it does play into the plot really well and just really make you think about the whole debate about this issue. I do actually have to respect the developers for how deep they went with this story. I mean, they actually researched into actual scientific theories and current progression of augmentation technology, So it could be realistic in 50 years' time. We could be actually experiencing this technology. It's amazing how deep they went to, what lengths they went to do this storyline. As the story progresses, you can take multiple story paths and routes.
You're doing better than you think. You're still standing, and that's more than the hacker was expecting.
In other words, certain characters can get killed off, certain events can and can't happen, certain subquests might not be unlocked. But really, it doesn't have a major effect on the story, but the effects it does have makes it feel more real and makes it feel like these events actually matter in somewhat in the whole grand scheme of things.
Of course, the attack on Sarah Finstrus was no simple attack. There's tons of conspiracy behind it, and the plot is intriguing enough to keep you hooked until the very end.
Being the achievement of whore I am, I went for a second playthrough, and I've got to say, I'm surprised how many details are on the storyline. I mean, at one point I missed one email, and because of that I didn't unlock a whole side quest. I completely missed out on it. You've really got to pay attention to every single little thing in this game. But the way the game's ending plays out is pretty disappointing. It pretty much makes your choices you made redundant. However, I feel the freedom is more in the playthrough of the game, rather than the way the game ends. So sit back and enjoy the ride. Speaking of freedom, let's move on to the gameplay aspects of the game. Gameplay-wise, it really follows the spirit of the original Deus Ex. Whilst it still blends the elements of RPG, first-person action, it really feels more like an action RPG, but it still works really well for the modern generation. You gotta bear in mind that this is a reboot of the series, so they've reinvented it for the modern era, so I think they've done pretty well. I mean, there's no skill system, but the way it's presented, the augmentation system is still really, really well done. I mean, you really have to make tough choices with what augmentations you want. You can't just have everything like most games. You know, the really big badass cyborg killer at the end of the game. You can't do that. You've got to really choose wisely. Really love the character, personalise which character you want to be. By that, I mean by specific roles. I mean, you could be a hacker. A stealth guy. You know, could go out all out action, be really good at shooting things. I mean, obviously the shooting aspect of the game is good, depends on if you're good at shooting or not. But there's little augmentation upgrades here and there that can help you out a little bit. I mean, it really does depend on your playstyle and how you play games. It really does cater for anyone, really. It really does cater to a wide audience, in the sense that you can level up your character in the way you want. However, the game is a bit biased towards stealth gameplay. This leads neatly on to the next aspect of the game I want to talk about. Augmentations.
Roll up, step right up, folks. Experience the wonderful, dazzling, incredible world of Sarah Industries augmentations. That's right, superpowers of the power of your fingertips. You, sir! Yes, you right there. Do you want the power of invisibility? Do you want the power of women? Try Sarah Industries invisibility augmentation. Get in there, Tiger. Pervert those women all you want. How about you, kind sir? Yes, you there. Do you want the power of jumping? That's right, folks. That's right. Help you to help with basketball. Jump higher. Help to get those so hard to reach places. Be the envy of your basketball team. Jump 20 feet in the air. Guaranteed satisfaction. And you, Mom. That's right, you there. Trouble lifting heavy objects? Do you want to lift all the heavy items in the world? Well, try Seraph Industries strength augmentation. That's right, those heavy to lift objects will be light as a feather. Throw them at enemies as well to cause chaos and havoc to them. That's right, Seraph Industries, try now. Only $99.99 for your starting package.
Terms and conditions apply. Seraph Industries is not responsible for death due to augmentations or augmentation rejection.
These augmentations really do open up new options in the gameplay. There's many multiple routes, multiple paths to take, multiple skill sets you can customise to do different things. For example, the hacking system. You get different levels of hacking, 1 to 5, depending on how hard and how highly secured each area is. And you really need to upgrade each of them to experience each different level of hacking, to get into higher security areas, to get better stuff, and to get into better locations. In fact, the hacking minigame itself is really unique. Basically, in the hacking, you have different control points, where you have to select the points, highlight them, select to tag them over, and you've got to keep going down the chain of different routes it can take. There's different icons that do different things. For example, some will slow down the trace of the hacking security software. Some will actually grant you little XP rewards or give you some cash. And there's many others that do many different other features. It is complicated to explain, but once you experience it and get used to it, it is a really unique and fun game to play. As for the way you gain these augmentations, that's also a pretty sophisticated system. Basically, for any action you take in the game, you get skill points, and once you get to 5,000, you get a praxis point. This point can be applied to any skill in the game you want, as long as that skill set is unlocked. But remember, these points are limited. You've got to really be careful about it. Like I said, you can't have a jack-of-all-trades character, but that's just the way the game is. Of course, near the end of the game, you can probably unlock most of the skill set, but you still have a few skills that are not unlocked. On my first playthrough, it was actually one skill I didn't get to the very end of the game, pretty much. That's how limited this game can really be.
And we've yet to...
Plus, you can choose how to react to people in different situations. For example, you could even be a nice guy.
Please, will you help me find out what really happened to her?
I never got a chance to investigate the attack myself. I'll look into it.
Or you can be a total dick. The latter of which is much more fun.
There's only two major gripes I really have for gameplay. First of all, on the Xbox 360, it might take a bit of getting used to the controls because it's a different layout compared to what most games are. But really, it's probably games like Call of Duty rewiring my brain. And the other aspect I'd like to mention that I don't really like too much is the difficulty level. When you first play the game, it is really, really difficult. I mean, it's really brutal. Once you get spotted by an enemy, they're relentless in getting you and killing you. I can honestly say the difficulty is like hitting a brick wall. Literally, it doesn't hold your hand, it doesn't tell you where to go so easily, it doesn't tell you how to do it, just bam, that's it.
Die!
In the end, you will get used to it. It's just such a unique style of game that you can't really place your finger on it like with other shooters and other standard RPGs. It is such a unique style of game, but some players might find it intimidating. Don't let that put you off though, because once you've got used to it, it's really rewarding to play. Graphically, the game isn't incredible. It's still pretty good, but not anything amazing. But the good thing about it is the art style. I absolutely adore the art style. It is to die for. They've blended the art styles of Renaissance and cyberpunk to create something truly spectacular, that truly reflects the storyline. Because in the Renaissance times, there was a time of revolution and great human development going on, and that's reflected in the storyline and in the art style, so it works really well.
Another element of the game's excellent presentation is a fantastic soundtrack. It's a great blend of electronic music with some organic elements. It truly does help to put an emphasis on the game's atmosphere and theme. Unfortunately, some of the animations are really dodgy. I mean, look at this for example. I wonder where I've seen that before.
R2-D2, where are you?
As for level design, you're given two hub worlds to explore, those being Detroit and later on in the game, Hengshire. The level design is pretty spectacular for both of them. They are pretty detailed, pretty varied.
My favourite hub world being Detroit. Because it's got the most detail of the two, it's got a more open space, and it just feels more alive and real. I mean, don't get me wrong, I still like Hengshire, but it just feels so enclosed and it's too confusing to navigate, especially when you consider the many side quests the game has to offer.
I mean, it's pretty easy to find and presented to you within the main story path, so they're not too difficult apart from one I mentioned earlier on in the review. But they are worth checking out. If you want every aspect of the story and the full experience, go play them all, because it is worth getting into these. Some of them even reveal parts of storyline and extra bits of story that you wouldn't get in the main questline. Deus Ex Human Revolution doesn't have any multiplayer, it doesn't need it. Next section, let's move on.
Last warning!
So overall, my final opinions on Deus Ex Human Revolution. This wasn't exactly the game I was expecting or hoping for, but it's still a really damn good game and it does live up to the Deus Ex name, definitely. It does the RPG elements well, the freedom's there, the whole original, it just lives up to the spirit of the original. It does feel like a Deus Ex game, it oozes the Deus Ex style. The environments are very immersive, it's atmospheric, it just oozes style, you can get lost in this world quite easily. I mean, the game's length as well, you can get lost in that. I mean, literally, my first playthrough is about, well, it's over 20 hours, possibly 20 to 30 hours, and I'm pretty damn impressed with that. That's like length of what? 6 or 7 Call of Duties, maybe? I mean, it does have its flaws. One thing I haven't pressed upon yet is boss fights. I mean, the original didn't have these in the game. I mean, why do they need it, really? I mean, they're just trying to follow a formula that's just cliched and it does take away the freedom. Literally, boss fights, stun, shoot, repeat. That's all you do in the boss fights. Literally, it's terrible.
The hell was that, kid?
Whilst it does have silly design decisions like that, it's definitely worth your time and it is a damn good game. In fact, I'm inclined to say this could very well be my favourite game of the year. All in all, I give this game 4 G's. It just misses out on the ultimate 5 out of 4 G's rating, but it's still worth your time and it's definitely incredible. It's so unique, it's different, it's what the game industry needs at the moment. We've got all these shooters that are just war shooters, but are all the same, and we've got some bits different, some breaks the mold. Immerse yourself in something different, play this game. It's worth your time, you will not be disappointed.
What can you tell me about this base?
Please, can't you get me out of here?
You said you think there's a black project going on inside the detention camp. Tell me more about these scientists.
Please, I don't want to disappear like all the others.
I want to help you, but you've got to stay calm.
As a little extra for this review as well, I've actually played the DLC, The Missing Link. Basically, in the DLC, you're a cargo ship, you've been caught, and you're trying to escape and get out and get to a later part in the game. Naturally, this does slot into the later half of the game, so I can't really say too much about the storyline, but it's meant to add more to the story and the plot, but it's quite good, but it's nothing new or innovative for the game, really. It doesn't really add anything extra. But, of course, if you're a hardcore Deus Ex fan, you're going to love it, obviously. The level design itself, it's quite good, but it's not exactly as wide or open or as innovative as the original game itself. There are new NPCs, new story plot elements, everything you expect from a DLC, but the one disappointment with the DLC was it's 5 hours long. And for 1200 Microsoft points, you can't really say that's a good deal. To be honest, I'd recommend something like Burnout Crash for 800 points. I'd say skip on the DLC until it's cheaper, or unless you're a really hardcore Deus Ex fan. Well, that's all from me, folks. Until next time, this is 4G signing off. Remember, keep on gaming.